a technology analyst at Credit Suisse and is a former head and Explore ML facilitator of DSC VIT Pune. He grabbed an off-campus placement at Credit Suisse. Today he is going to cover everything concerning off-campus placements, internships, and job opportunities. He will also provide a list of 100 companies currently hiring, the way he prepared, and he will also be sharing important resources as well. Okay, so this webinar is going to be very helpful for everyone, right from FYs to final year people. So make sure that you stay tuned with us till the very end of this session. And also I would like to mention one thing, that grab a piece of paper and pen with you, because you guys want to make a lot of notes today. I am very sure this is going to be one insightful session, and also we are not going to be sharing the PPTs and the deck for today's session with you all. So yeah, without any further ado, let's quickly get started. Over to you, Afan. Thank you so much for
Thanks, Kritika, for that introduction. Hi everyone. My name is Afan, and I'm currently working as a technology analyst, as Kritika said. So without any further introduction, let's move to the PPT which I have for you guys. And like Kritika said, I would also recommend you guys to note everything I speak, because it's a presentation. I've not written exact points. I've just written the key points in it, and it's going to be more of what I say. And I'll definitely try to cover everything from first year to second year, and also let you know about opportunities. How did I get them? What are the some opportunities which might be currently open, and all those kind of things. So yeah, let's go to the PPT. Can you guys just let me know if you can see my screen?
Yes, Afan, the screen is visible.
All right. So let's begin. Initially, let me just tell you about what are the different things I'm going to talk about. So our topic is off-campus, right? So there are two parts to it. One is the applying phase, where you're actually going to find out opportunities, different opportunities off-campus. And the second one is actually cracking it. I think the first one is easy. I'll also tell you about how to get those opportunities. But the tougher part is the second one, I guess. So I think my major focus would be on the second one, how you can crack those opportunities. And at the end of it, I'm going to give you a list of opportunities which I think might be pretty relevant for you guys. So I'll be covering which kind of resume helped me get an off-campus opportunity with Credit Suisse, how exactly you can create an impact through your resume, because everyone is having a resume, everyone is having projects, everyone is having internships. So how exactly can you stand out of a big crowd which is applying to off-campus opportunities? Then something about interviews, which are the core of off-campuses. There might be some people who are from first year, some might be from second year. So for them also, a beginner overview of how exactly an engineer, you know, learns about coding. How did I learn about coding? How exactly I prepared for my interviews? The entire phase, how it was, I'll explain you that. Then there are some key points you should try, and you should follow during your preparations. There is always a coding round before any company you go for. In general, it's 90% of the companies today actually are taking the first round as coding round. Initially, it was different. It was more of like aptitude, English verbal, and all those kind of things were also there. But right now, today, it's more of, you know, you'll get 2-3 questions, you'll get 2 hour, 1 hour, and you just have to solve that. So we'll speak about that. Apart from that, the computer science fundamentals are pretty important. The virtual interview, as you all know, today it's the pandemic going on. So in that, the interviews are virtual. I'll explain you how it is different to interview on site and interviewing virtual. Then competitive coding is pretty important. So solving those questions, modularization of code, which I think I wish I knew when I started my preparation, and how to get unstuck. Basically, what happens, everyone is getting stuck when they are in an interview. The interview gives you a question. What you can do to get unstuck at that point. The biggest question, tech stack versus interview preps. Should we do competitive coding or go and prepare for techs? We'll discuss on that. How placements and internship differ. What should be your plan about it? And lastly, I have 3 different slides on off-campus opportunities. I'll show you how to get them. I'll even tell you whom to follow, where you can find these opportunities and everything. So to start with, the first thing is the resumes. Now, whenever you are applying for an off-campus, whenever you are going to apply for an off-campus, the first important thing is your resume, because that is the first screening stage. So first important thing you need to understand, in a job description, there is a basic qualification section written. Every job description has a basic qualification, and there are some points mentioned in that basic qualification. Let's take, for example, if it's a summer internship, they'll explicitly mention we are looking for penultimate year students. So if you're in your final year, if you're in your second year, and if you're in your first year, that opportunity is not for you. But if you're in your third year, that opportunity is exactly for you. And you should somewhere mention that you're currently in your third year. Not explicitly write third year, but write your graduation year, expected graduation 2021. So start with basic details in your resume. For example, your LinkedIn profile, your contact number, your email ID. LinkedIn profile gives it a more professional look. If you have a very good GitHub repo, I didn't have one, let's be frank. And yeah, I'll make sure I'm very much frank with you guys and tell you everything, how I changed what I was and what I am today. So I didn't have a GitHub repo that good. I don't have it till yet because I'm working in a company. So we usually have our own projects going on. But I would definitely recommend get your projects onto GitHub. Then objective is optional. People do write objectives. You can just get an objective online on Google. Just type good objectives for software engineers and you can get one. That's optional. That's a debatable topic. Some people do say you should have it. Some people do say you shouldn't have it. In my earlier resumes, I had mentioned it, but right now I don't mention that anymore. Your education is pretty important. That's what I'm telling you. Since the basic qualification explicitly says candidate should be in your penultimate year, you have to somehow tell them that you are starting in your penultimate year. That's the biggest mistake people do. They just write that they are pursuing BTech in some college and they mention their CGPA. Now, how will the HR know what is your current graduation year? When are you going to graduate? Which year you are in? And that's where they are, you know, going to neglect your resume. Go ahead with other people who have mentioned it. Experience section is very, very important. Please don't do this thing. That's a very, very big misconception that if you're a part of a college club, that counts in your experience. No, when you say experience, that's a corporate experience. You do internship with startups, you do internship with good MNCs or normal companies. That is what experience is. Your club is not an experience, is not something which you can put in experience. I'll tell you why. And that actually happened this year itself. One of my juniors who was applying to Credit Suisse off campus. So I was helping him out and I didn't see his resume. It was more of helping him out on phone. And later when he got selected, so those guys asked, can you give us a certificate that you are working at this particular club? Because you had mentioned it in your experience section. So he had to go back to those background verification team and explicitly tell them that this is not an experience, this is not an internship, this is not a position which I am actually working at, rather it's a college club. So please don't include that. That's absolutely wrong to include it. You can put it in your extracurricular section. So projects, I'll explain you how to put your projects in, and it's a must. Don't just do that. You have one or two projects. Up to your third year, you might have made around 3-4 projects at least. So put some quality projects. Make sure those are variable in different tech stack. Make sure those cover the fundamental things. Like don't just go on and put research projects. Projects. Also put some projects which actually show you as a developer that you have developed something. This is the most important section, I guess, the curricular section. If you cannot show some achievements in your first 3 years of your engineering, then how exactly will you show what is different in you as compared to the rest of the crowd? So your curricular achievements are very, very important. So let's say, for example, for me, my curricular achievement being, our team stood first from around 25 participating teams. So I would put that as my achievement. Like I was featured as a star performer within the first 5 months of my career in Credit Suisse. So that's my achievement. That is something which I have. That is something which no other resume would have it. So curricular achievements is very, very important because extracurricular is something which other people will also have it. Let's say, for example, you are a head of a particular club. So similarly, there can be other people who are also head of a club. But let's say, for example, you have won a particular hackathon, which is at India level. There might be very less people who have done that. So a curricular is very important. In your extracurricular section, don't just go and mention you stood first in your dance competition or something like that. It's not so relevant to a software engineering internship. Hardly some companies would consider that, but don't put those things. Rather put things like you managed an entire club. You actually managed your juniors and you deployed a project with them. You are actually managing a complete event, some technical event. You actually managed conferences, something like that. That comes into your extracurricular section. How exactly can you create an impact? So let's take two examples. There's a particular person who comes in and on his resume, it's written developed a website for XYZ organization. Now this person has just written this single line, developed a website for XYZ organization. Now same work is done by someone else. Now let's see how this guy writes, and you will actually understand what the difference is. So this person will write developed a website for XYZ organization using a tech stack. Why? Website is currently live with 3000 plus, let's say for example, clients currently using it. So that extra part, that measurement part, you should measure your work. And that's how you stand out from the crowd. If you're going to just write that you developed an API, there are five more people who have developed an API. But if you mention that you developed that API and that API is currently being used or is currently being deployed or is actually impacting or actually reduced 30% of the time your company was initially or your project was initially taking to work out, so that's where you create an impact on the interviewer. So at every point, make sure you highlight your measurement. Measure your things. Let's say, for example, I stood in top six. I was the finalist of Coded Swiss. That's where I got a off-campus internship. Now try to understand it from the other angle. So initially, I write that finalist of Coded Swiss, Credit Swiss Hackathon 2019. That's it. This is one way of writing it. Now, if I want to create, this doesn't create an impact. This just says that, yeah, you were a finalist in some XYZ competition. But how do I put it on my resume? Stood in top six amongst 3,500 plus participating students from all over India and grabbed an off-campus internship at Credit Suisse. So this creates an impact. So whenever you're writing your resume, make sure you're actually creating impact. Use concepts like behavior-driven development or test-driven development, in the sense that you were actually testing out every single component you were building, or use software engineering principles like agile methodology. You had used agile methodology to actually make that particular project. So these are the things you can do. The most debatable topic is one page or two page. So I think it's up to you. I can get you five experienced recruiters who will tell you that one page hi chahiye. At the same time, I can get you five experienced recruiter who will say that it's pretty clumsy in a one-page resume. We want two-page resume. So it's entirely up to you. What do you think, right? How do you want to project it? Just look at it from this angle, that someone else who doesn't have any idea about you is going to look at that. If you want some awesome templates where you can find some awesome resume templates, you can go to overleaf.com. There, the LaTeX language is there. I also didn't know about LaTeX language, but we guys are engineers, right? At the end of the day, we can pick up things. We know how things work. It takes us time to figure out. So I also figured it out within half an hour, 1 hour, how LaTeX is working. And I built up my resume. So I hope you guys can hear me. I'm just confirming in between.
Yes, yes, you're perfectly audible, Afan.
Okay, sure. Now coming to, I'll be explicitly speaking about software developer interviews and how an off-campus interview, what are the different things you can expect in an off-campus interview. So the first thing which is very important is data structures and algorithm, your competitive coding. Now there's a very, very big misconception, I think. And that's when you guys say, you need to be a CodeSafe 6-star, you need to be a HackerRank 5-star, you need to be a lead code solver with 700 problems. And those kind of things. You don't need, actually, it's good to have that, but it's not competitive coding which is going to give you an edge over others. Rather, it's the problem solving ability. Can you solve the problem and explain your thought process to the interviewer? That's what is required. Any coach, anyone can sit and continuously code on different things. They'll do it for 1 year. But if they are not able to express themselves, like right now I'm expressing what I mean to say, if you are not able to express that's the problem statement, if you're not able to explain him how did you get the solution, if you're not able to explain him what is the brute force, what is the time complexity, what is the space complexity, then it becomes pointless even if you're a hacker rank 5-star. So that problem solving ability, to practice that problem solving, to gain that problem solving ability, you need competitive coding and data structured algorithms. Don't have that misconception that if you become a 5-star code chef or, you know, 5-star hacker rank or a code chef 6-star, you know everything. No, it's not that way around. I've solved more than, I'm not sure, I guess more than 700, 800 problems, but that's, if you go to my code chef profile, I don't have a code chef profile. I used to do something on HackerRank, but if you go to my lead code, I have solved problems there. But the base being, I'm learning problem solving. I'm not learning how to do competitive coding. Just know how STL stack works and directly go and implement it. I should understand how the internally push and pop operations of a stack are working. So that's very important, data structures and algos. The second thing, important thing, is the projects. You will be grind on technology which is written in your projects. You won't, let's say for example, you are interviewing for an X company or for off campus, and there the role is for a full stack developer. And they've kept a generalized role open for all final year students. Now you go there with a profile in AI, right? So they are not going to ask you questions on blockchain and AI. So that tech stack depends entirely on your profile. If you've written, you know, NLP, they'll ask you what is LSTM, how attention mechanism works, things like those. Now, after your projects, I'll go into depth about projects as well in the next slides. Now coming to your core subjects. So what happened with us was we didn't know what to prepare for an interview. We used to go online. My first interview was with NVIDIA. That was on campus, but I didn't know what to prepare. But I went on to different sites. I contacted a few people, and there I learned that you have to study these things. But over the time when I gave interviews, I realized there's a lot of things which you have to do. It's not just any particular single subject, or it's not only data structures, algos. So it's a combination of all these things. They ask you questions on object-oriented programming. They ask you questions on operating system, database management system, computer networks. These are the main topics they are more concerned about, because these are things which actually are being used. Like for example, my credits internship, I was actually forking, doing some, creating child process of a thread. If I didn't understand operating system, how would I understand what are threads? So operating system is very important. Database management systems. Now, if you don't know how to do basic SQL queries, if you're not aware of these things, how do you expect them to hire you and ask you to work on a back end and, you know, interact with the database and everything? So that's also very important. Similarly goes for computer networks. Now, how exactly, are you even going to, I'll cover that, how exactly, from where you can prepare these topics. And what happens is, this is a very huge topic, competitive coding, projects ka tech stack, core subjects, mein char subjects hai. So I'll tell you how to prepare for that as well. Now coming to aptitude, comparatively, many off-campus opportunities, many of those, and even the interviews today, they are trying to remove this part. Like for example, if you go to Google and if you go on sites at Google, you'll realize there's no aptitude involved. So it varies from company, but if you go to Goldman Sachs for an off campus, which happens in July every year, definitely it happens. This time it happened thrice, I guess. So at that particular time, when my juniors were giving that, they realized that aptitude is something which is being asked very much, logical aptitude, verbal reasoning, and even something like maths and everything. So I'll tell you where to prepare these things for. Now, so if you're in first year or second year, let's understand what happens when you are in final year, you learned what data structures, how exactly that flow goes. Initially, you master a language. People usually are confused, yeah, C++ karna ya Java karna. I'll say C++, if you're good with it, go ahead with it, but don't say that you don't know Java. If you're good with Java, but don't say that you don't know C++. You have that fear in yourself that interviewer might ask you about Java and you haven't done Java. Simply sit down for a day, go and do a crash course on YouTube on Java, get it done within 3 hours, and get that thing out of your mind that Java nahi aata hai. I did that. मुझे थर्ड ईयर तक के बहुत इश्यूज हो रहे थे जावा में. आई वाज लाइक कंफ्यूज यार, ये जावा क्या करना है. एंड सिंपली सम आई जस्ट वेंट टू यूट्यूब. आई सॉ यार 2 आवर्स का क्रैश कोर्स है, एक दिन में पूरा खत्म कर लेते हैं प्रैक्टिस करने के साथ. वंस आई डिड दैट, आफ्टर दैट आई वॉज नॉट इवन स्केर्ड अबाउट जावा. सो यू डिसाइड वॉट यू वॉन्ट टू गो. यू कैन इधर गो फॉर C++, STL यूज कर सकते हो, या फिर जावा के अंदर कंटेनर यूज कर कलेक्शन यूज कर सकते हो. सॉरी बट नेवर से टू एन इंटरव्यू दैट यू डोंट नो जावा, बिकॉज दोज आर फंडामेंटल लैंग्वेजेस. यू आर एक्सपेक्टेड टू नो देम. इट्स इन जनरल द इंटरव्यूअर्स गिव यू अ चॉइस, लाइक वेदर यू वॉन्ट टू कोड इन जावा वेदर C++. मेनी ऑफ माई इंटरव्यूज दे गेव मी अ चॉइस, बट इट just don't go and if they ask you a question like what is finally in java or what is final keyword in java, how multiple why doesn't multiple inheritance work in java, so you cannot tell them sir I'm not comfortable with java, can you ask in C++, because that's a conceptual thing. He's not writing asking you to write syntactical code. So get yourself acquainted with both the languages and master one for competitive coding or whatever coding which you do. The next phase is you learn data structure. This usually happens in your second year. And this is where your fundamentals are developed, how exactly you know data structures. Now, before going to your off-campus placement, before going for your interview, what you have to do is you have to create a list of all the data structures you know. Okay, so I'll create a list of tree, graph, stack, queues, linked list, arrays, heaps. And what I'll do is I'll mark myself, I'll rate myself from 10 in all those things. So let's take, for example, for my case, when I was in my final year, and I was trying to get an off-campus placement. That's where, when I was preparing, so what I did, I wrote down a list of all the data structures, and I realized I'm actually lacking in dynamic programming. I'm actually lacking in strings and sliding window. So I picked those topics first. I cleared out my weaknesses first. You already know how a tree works. You already know breadth first search, depth first search of a tree. You know graphs. But you're struggling with dynamic programming. So sit down for a day or two, complete 10 different problems on those things which you actually are lacking at, which is actually your weakness. So this create your list is actually going to tell you for your off-campus placement, which are the topics you are actually struggling with. Usually what people do is wo sirf jaake interview experience padh lete and their interview experience ke andar stacks cover ho gaya, queues cover ho gaya, linked list ho gaya. Recursion ho gaya, backtracking ho gaya, and then graphs bhi ho gaya. But in your interview, you get to know your dynamic programming pucha, and you haven't even touched that. So very simple. Let's take for an example. Dijkstra's built came up with an algorithm, right? Shortest path algorithm. So you never have studied what shortest path algorithm is, because you never created a list of different data structures and different algorithms. So you never created that list. You never know that Dijkstra's algorithm exists or not. Now you go into your interview and interview ask you Dijkstra's algorithm. That is the most common problem, but you haven't solved it anytime. You're not a scientist. You're not just going to come up with a solution in 30 minutes, which a scientist actually took years to come up with. So base concepts jo hota hai na, wo tumhe pehle se aane chahiye. Uske upar tumhara thinking develop hota hai. So clear your weaknesses first. Clear things you're not comfortable with. Clear your strengths if you're actually struggling with it. And then you shift to concepts. When I say concepts, I mean, here it was your data structures. When I say concepts, it's more of backtracking, dynamic programming. Now, since you never know what is the basic way a backtracking algorithm works, how are you going to solve different backtracking problems? So it's your duty to list down the different things which you have learned. You have to mark them across and see where you are lacking. Moving forward, recognizing pattern and using templates. So there, I do have a resources post on my LinkedIn. Do check that. In that, I have written where you can find the patterns and templates. There are some basic templates and patterns for competitive coding. What happens is you are on the stage where you have practiced all your data structures. You know what your weaknesses are. You've done good kind of coding and everything. Now you start. Your brain starts to think about different patterns. Let me give you an example of a very general problem. So let's take, for example, you are given coins. You're given a coin of 5 rupees, and you're given multiple coins of 5 rupees and 2 rupees, and you have to make a sum of 11. So what is the minimum number of ways you can make that sum? So in a very simple answer, you can say 5 + 5 + 1. So you are taking 3 coins, right? So your answer is 3. Now, what will happen in an interview? They're not going to give you this question directly. What they do is they say you are an employer you are a company, you want to take your employees out for a trip, and there are three different types of vehicles. So the first vehicle has a capacity of 5, the second vehicle is having a capacity of 2, and the third vehicle is having a capacity of 1. And you now have to take 11 people to a trip. So what is the minimum number of vehicles you required? Again, you have to take 11 people, you have capacity of 5, 2, and 1. Again, the answer comes same, 5 plus 5 plus 1, which is 3. So this is where you recognize patterns and use predefined templates to solve your problem. Once you're at this stage where your brain is actually, you know, trying to relate things, it's able to understand that this is how this problem can be solved, it's able to grasp different things, then you move to competitions. When I say competitions, I'm not saying about Kickstart, Code Jam and everything. I'm saying about basic bi-weekly competitions. Lead code keeper, you can go there, you can try out that. And simultaneously, you can move on to advanced data structure. Now, the biggest question, if you ask a final year student, that advanced data structure aayenga kya nahi interview mein? So the only answer they give is nahi aayenga. Now, there's a different way to look at it. You don't want to solve segment trees. You don't want to go for a try. You don't want to do red, black tree. You don't want to do AVL tree. That's absolutely fine. But what if that comes into your interview? You might get screwed. So how to go about that? Pretty simple. Instead of just thinking that this is a whole different another topic, take that topic, understand it, and take it as an another problem in your preparation. Instead of just looking at it, it's an advanced level data structure, take it as a problem, take it as a hard level problem, solve it, learn how to use it, and then move ahead with advanced data structure. So that thing in your mind which always picks you down and says, yeah, advanced data structures, that goes away, and you're simply so you get so familiar with it that you start using it. Like for my example, I am currently using try in my work at Credit Suisse. I work on NLP. So there is something I used right now. So I knew how try's work. I implemented that as well. But when I go to Credit Suisse, I am directly using a library. And there we reduce the complexity from initially there were 56,400 different words which had to be searched. Those were in a data frame that takes order of n, order of 56,400. But I reduced that to order of 12 because the maximum size of the word was 12. I reduced the time complexity. The space did increase, but it increased in just KBs. Like it's 26 into maximum of number of length of your string. So that way, and into the number of into the number of entries you have, right? So that did increase. So initially my data frame was having 417 KB. That increased to 1500 KB. My manager was comfortable with that, but he saw that pehle 10 second lag rahe the hame search karne ke liye data frame ke andar, abhi wo 4-5 seconds lag rahe the, and now we are able to use try and get it done within milliseconds. So that approach is pretty much faster, because searching 56,400 entries and searching 12 entries is very fast than 56,400. So you take these advanced data structures as problems, as something you should use and solve out different problems. Now you are participating in competitions, you are actually recognizing patterns, and you understood the base of what data structures is. Now you want a direction in which you want to work. So what you can simply do is, there are good YouTubers. I don't want to name anyone, but there are many good YouTubers who are actually putting out great content. You follow them, you might know about them. So there is someone who's put 180 product-based questions. I solved that entire list. And that gave me a direction to what my current preparations are going. I covered arrays, I covered strings, I covered matrices, I covered backtracking, dynamic programming, everything into it. So I reached till that stage only. I didn't went for higher competitions like code. I gave Code Jam, I gave Kickstart, I even gave Hashcode. I got rankings, but I was not able to come in the top 5 people, top 100 people in India. So it was that way. So I reached till this level. You try and reach till the higher competitions, because that will eventually give you a very good edge in your off-campus placements. Now, during your preparations, you need to create your own area. Like for example, I have my own folder on Drive wherein I have everything. I have my OSC and DBMSK notes, I have my competitive coding doc, everything is there. So I have my area where I actually prepare and measure myself how much am I preparing for my off-campus placements. Right now, everything is off-campus for me only because I'm no more a student. Moving forward, there's a preparation doc. Stop using IDE, stop using auto-complete features when you are actually coding competitive coding questions. Start using docs. Google Docs use karo. Wahan pe you will actually realize how exactly an interview is. You don't get autocomplete features. That will increase your syntax, the way you write syntax. That will help you build your syntax. And simultaneously, you should follow some good practices. There are small snippets or small videos on YouTube which actually say how to write clean code. These things make you stand out of the crowd when you're applying for an off-campus. Trust me, if anyone just comes and says, this guy got off-campus placement, that guy got off-campus placement, it's pretty easy. No, it's not easy. You have to work hard such that it becomes easy for you. It's not that anyone can just go up and say, yeah, I'm going to get off-campus placement. If you're working hard, then anyone can do it. So you need to work hard in the right direction. So stop using autocomplete, Visual IDE, Visual Studio, don't code there, competitive coding question, go to preparation doc. Create a list of data structures and approaches, which I just mentioned. And similarly, you have resources. I'm just checking with the comments, guys. Are you guys able to hear me, right?
Yes, we were able to hear you fine, Afan.
Okay, sure. Then there is something which is called as tough ones. I created this word up. You can call it anything you want, but I realized that interview preparations karte na, to ye bahut bar hota hai. And let me explain you what that is. So let's take for example, you solved the KMP algorithm the first time you saw it and you learned how it is. You read the theory, you pehle to wo samjha nahi bilkul, then you actually went to a YouTube guy, he taught you very good and you are now able to code it. 1 week passes, you try and do the same problem again, you're again stuck. You don't know how it's working. You're again stuck. So I did that KMP algorithm 3 times, but I was still stuck after 3 weeks. Then I realized that this is something I'm struggling with. So I created a list of tough questions which are tough specifically for me. And what I do is before my interview, I just walk through those tough questions. So that I'm not scared in my interview ke yaar wo tough wala question aayega na to mujhe aayega nahi because wo to maine kal hi karke aa gaya hu. So that gives me a pretty high confidence that I'm not going to get stuck in one of those tough questions which I had prepared pehle and I'm struggling it with still. Like code dekh ke hi code karne aata hai. So for those questions, you make a list of all those questions which are your weaknesses and you constantly keep going through them. Every 2-3 days you go and do one of those problems. Every 2-3 days you go and do one of those problems. That what exactly that does is that builds the logic inside it. Like if you actually go and read DBMS, right? I mean, DBMS mein views hai, transactions. Every time I read it, I find it. I get to learn something new from it. Aise bahut bar hua hai, that happens. So similarly, every time you solve this problem, you'll get a different perception about it, and eventually you will understand how that problem is actually working and your brain won't be frustrated on the day of interview. What if he asked me that question? What if he asked me that question? That creates a problem. Now, biggest thing, I think, I don't know if any one of you has ever tried this, but please, in off campus, everything is virtual right now going on. And one-on-one interviews, even if it's not virtual, one-on-one interviews are going on. Try and see how you speak. Try and see how you are able to explain a problem. If you will realize that solving a problem is a whole different thing, and actually explaining it to your interview is a whole different thing. Those things are way different. So you do one thing. If you're finding it little, if you're feeling shy in front of your friend, just open your camera on a Google Meet, be alone there and try to talk yourself and record what you speak. Try to explain that question to someone. And one more thing, if let's say, for example, you are studying for 2 hours and you have 1 hour, may you are able to solve one medium good problem and you're going for the second one. It's good to go for the second one, but just do one thing before that. Ask any of your friends to just join in on Google Meet. Ask him, can you just help me out with this? This is the question. I'll explain the logic to you. Can you tell me if you understand what I'm saying, because that's the biggest thing. You are preparing competitive coding, you are doing OS, you know what deadlocks is, but when someone asks you a question, those words which come out of your mind, of your mouth, are way different than what your mind thinks. That creates a very big problem. So before, let's take for example, in my final year interviews, before my interview with Google, I had given one off campus with Google. I had given many mock interviews. So there's one site, pram.com. I had my friends who were helping me out. One of my friend helped me out. So I gave 6-7 interviews with her, and I asked her to criticize me on everything I miss. If I'm stumbling on something, if I'm not able to make you understand that, criticize me for that. I will understand where exactly I'm making a mistake. This is a whole different thing when you're actually coding something on LeetCode, where you're actually studying what deadlock is, what transactions are, what asset properties are, what is UDP, what is TCP. That's one separate thing, and explaining it to someone else is a separate thing. So definitely go for mocks. Biggest thing, I think resume stories are very important. This is again my term. I like to make terms for myself. I just put it wherever I can. So before going to your interview, you have to predict the interview. Let me give you an example. So one of my friends, we were preparing for, I like to help out juniors on my weekends. So we were preparing, I was teaching him how to give an interview, and I was taking a mock interview. So there were four projects mentioned, and the fourth project was something I saw, and I started grinding him on that. When I started grinding him on that, after the interview was over, he told me, I'm most probably going to remove this project from my resume. I'm not comfortable with it. So I just asked him one thing, in the first place, why did you put it when you're not so comfortable? He said, I think it's good. So I just suggested him, it's pretty good. Do one thing, add a GUI to it. Add a, basically graphical user interface. Uska ek acha sa chota sa pop-up bana lo C++ Python ke andar. Aur ek chota sa pop-up bana ke ready kar lo usko. It would look pretty good. He did that. That was still on the fourth project only. I explained him how to create an impact, in the sense that don't just say you built a website. Like I said before, don't just say you built a website. Tell what are the different pages you built in that. Tell how it's impacting the project you're working on. Tell how many people are using it. This guy went into the credits to his interview. He was asked only on that project, and he answered everything I told him how to answer and how to create an impact. At the end of the interview, the interviewer tells him, your fourth project is something which is very impressive. And that guy gets selected in credits. So what I want to say here is, before going to your interview, predict what questions can be asked. Take your project, put it into a real life situation. What I'll do is, I've built a website, I'll put it into a real life situation. Or let's say, for example, I've built a prediction model on AI or something. I'll put it into a real life situation. I'll see what are the problems. They might ask me why the data is less. They might ask me, why didn't you go for different algorithms? So what I did was, before going for an interview, I took out each of my experience. I took out everything I worked on. I started criticizing it. Isme ye kyun nahi hai, usme wo kyun nahi kiya, why didn't you put this over here? I started criticizing it, and I wrote all those questions. And after that, I wrote answers for all those questions. Now, when I went to the interview, I have a complete idea what the interview is going to ask me. And I go with that confidence, bhai jo puchna hai puch le, mujhe pata hai tu resume mein mere ye project se tu in pe kya puch sakta hai. I am pretty confident, maine OSC and DBMS kiya hai, mera OOPS bhi strong hai, mujhe data structures ka base idea pura pata hai. I am not damn sure that I might solve the entire problem, but I am pretty damn sure I might come up with a brute force solution. So that's what builds up your resume story. Take your resume, read it out, ask them, and give your resume to someone who doesn't know you or doesn't know about the project. Like usually we have groups mein hum project karte na. Ask someone else to come in and tell him, yaar ye maine project mention kiya hai. Just read that two-line description and tell me whether you understand the project or not. If he says he doesn't understand, you need to change that line. You need to actually write out things which people understand. You go out to people and ask them, can you just check this and tell me whether you are understanding what is written? And that's how you create your resume story. You pre-predict your interview before even giving it, so that the element of surprise suddenly coming, like, why didn't you go for a CNN? why didn't you go for an LSTM, or why didn't you go, because I'm working in, I'm taking those as examples. Why didn't you go into this field, this particular project? Why is your project not deployed? Everything. That element of surprise is completely removed, and you know what to answer well before even the interviewer asks you that question. You know what are the possible questions he's going to ask you on that project. So definitely do that. If you're using LeetCode, CodeChef, any of those sites, you first hit, people have a bad habit of hitting submit. Don't hit the submit button. First hit the run button. Second thing you do is you try to come up with test cases that might fail your algorithm. Understand it as that you are a judge or wo kisi aur ka project hai, tumhe kisi bhi halat mein usko todna hai. You just have to criticize this. You just have to make sure that that algorithm fails. Come up with such test cases. If you're not able to come up, then click the submit button. Your solution will definitely get passed. So that mental ability to come up with test cases actually tells your interviewer how strong you understood the problem. So do that. Every problem wants to teach you something. Okay. Don't just go and solve it. Yeah, I solved it. I submitted it. I'm done. No, it's not that way. There are some techniques. I'll give you an example. What I mean to say, every problem teaches you something. You solve a particular problem. It will show you how to find intersection between two meetings. It will show you how to use two pointer technique to traverse a string. It will teach you how to do a depth first search of a graph. It will teach you how to do a topological sort of a graph. Understand what the problem wants to teach you. Do that. And see, people are always doing this thing. I see many people, they've scored LeetCode pe 400, 500 questions. I've just covered 300. What they're going to do is, usme bahut sare easy questions hai. So instead of solving 20 easy questions, it's better that you solve 10 easy questions and 2-3 medium questions. Why exactly am I telling that? That is keeping you challenging. That's actually tickling your brain to actually struggle and come up with a solution which you don't know, which you cannot solve. So do that thing. Don't just keep on solving easy problems. Yeah, it's good to solve. Go out and start with a medium problem. Okay, you're not able to solve it. Think about it. It's been 1 hour, you're not able to solve it. You're getting frustrated. When that frustration comes, go back to the easy problem, solve two problems, come back again to your main problem. But don't just go and see the solution. And if you're pretty much comfortable with medium problems, try doing hard problems. At every point of your practice, there should be something challenging or something new to learn. If it's pointless doing 7 different problems, which are again DFS only. You solve 70 problems, which are having 7 different concepts, and the interviewer asks you a concept, which is the 8th concept that's on breadth first search, and you've never seen that. So that creates a problem. But same way, if you're doing DFS for 7 different stories or 7 different applications, then that makes a difference. If you're solving it on easy problems, easy mein utna wo variations leke nahi aate, they don't put up that story thing, they don't put up that edge cases and all those kind of thing. So that creates a problem. Now, very simple, you need to come up with different solutions. See, all this is very important from an off-campus point of view, because if you don't do these things and you just normally go into an interview, there might be 500 more people who are just performing as you are doing. That's what's happening today. Everyone knows, everyone is going to an interview, but not everyone is cracking it, right? So you need to come up with different approaches. You sorted the array. Okay, that's good. Now tell him that you can do it with a heap as well. Tell him that you are only concerned about the maximum, so you can just do it in an order of n traversal. Tell him you are only concerned about the two maximums. Tell him you can do it in order of n traversal. Tell him different approaches which fail as well. Tell this to your interview. He will at least understand that you are thinking and you know what the problem statement is. Many a times you are on LeetCode, you're submitting your question and it says better than 5% of people. That actually tells you are not writing the solution which the problem is asking. You're doing a brute force solution and it is just getting accepted. The TLE thing is not working. So try to keep it above 30%. This number is actually something I've written. It's absolutely onto you, but understand what it wants to teach you. And there are some misleading questions on LeetCode. When I was doing LeetCode, I understood, and even other sites as well. So you need to just go into the discussion section and see if that problem is misleading or not. And also, if you see the dislike button there, you can actually find how good the problem statement is. Now, in your off-campus placement, the first round, how exactly are these guys even getting shortlisted for an off-campus placement? So first, the screening round, I told you how you can create an impact on your resume. Rather than just mentioning what you did, mention the impact using some measure. Do that. That's the screening stage. If your profile is matching the basic qualifications, you are definitely going to go inside. But what happens in the first round? That's the coding round. If 800 people are applying for a coding round, they shortlist 60, 70 people. And I think that's where the 740 people are out. That's the first important stage of your off-campus. You actually have to be very good at competitive coding. I mean, problem solving, I would say, not competitive coding. So there are three things. It can either be an MCQs plus a coding round, it can be a only coding round, or it can be an only MCQs round. I've also written a post on this. Do read that, but I'll still explain you here. If you're given two questions, you're given 1 hour, make sure you're looking at the timer and you have to guarantee yourself that within the first 30 minutes, you're going to solve the first problem. I'll tell you one situation. There was one coding round which I was giving. It's back in my final year itself. And in the first, when I first opened that link, there was 1 hour given and there were only two questions. I couldn't understand what the problem statement has to say. I was struggling for first 5 minutes, but I just knew one thing. Okay, that's absolutely fine. I am struggling, but the problem comes when the 30-minute timer crosses. The problem doesn't come before it. It's absolutely okay if I'm stuck. I'll get out in the next 25 minutes. When I solved that problem, I finished it in the next 15 minutes, and I even got 10 minutes extra to solve my next problem. So that hyperness is there. And that hyperness and that, you know, that's scared, you actually have that fear inside you. I'm not able to solve what I'm gonna do. That actually affects your time and you won't even realize. I mean, jisne interviews ya coding round diya, unko pata honga yaar. Pata hi nahi chalta ki coding round kab khatam ho gaya. Yes, you're busy doing cout scene, you're busy initializing your variables, the timer runs off. So have a quick watch. Always make sure you know, pre-plan that you're going to solve it in the first half an hour, pre-plan that you're going to solve the next part in the next half an hour. I have written a post on how to get unstuck. I'll explain that in the next slide. And biggest mistake, I guess, we made, you guys are also making that, everyone does, that is you read the 70% of the problem and think what the problem is. You assume what the problem is and start coding it out. After you are done coding, your test cases fail, and then you realize in the next 30% of your problem statement, there is something constraint written, and that's actually affecting your entire algorithm, and that completely wastes your half an hour. So don't do that. That really creates a problem. Oops, core subject and apti. I'll tell you, like, every single one of you in final year is confused. Yeah, we had done that back in second year and third year. How am I able to even remember it? It's pretty simple. You have done that in the sense you know what the concepts are, okay? But I do understand you're not gonna just, if someone asks you, you won't be able to explain it because you are not able to recall. So first thing is get those same notes from your teachers, or I don't know, where did you study from? Get those notes first, complete it. See, if you're able to, everyone knows, before our exams, ek din mein hum 6-6 unit cover karte hain. Main bhi karta tha, sab karte hain. Wo karna hi padta hai. So you also do that. A Saturday, Sunday comes, sit down with OS, get your OS done in that Saturday, Sunday. बट क्या होता है कि हाँ, ये सैटरडे संडे ओएस कवर कर लिया, अगले सैटरडे संडे डीबीएमएस हो गया, उसके बाद कंप्यूटर नेटवर्क्स हो गया, एंड नेक्स्ट वीक आई डिड ओप्स एंड देन आई हैव माय इंटरव्यू, बट पता चला यार ओएस तो 4 हफ्ते पहले किया था, सो हाउ एम आई इवन गोइंग टू रिमेंबर व्हाट आई डिड. सो दैट्स वेयर द यू नो द कंसेप्ट ऑफ मोस्ट आस्क्ड क्वेश्चंस कम इनटू पिक्चर. इफ यू गो ऑन, I've put the link in my resources post. If you go on that post, you will find there are most asked questions in OS, there are most asked questions in DBMS, there are most asked questions in computer networks, and there are same as for OOPS. What happens is you go into your interview, you have done 50 most asked questions 1 day before your interview. That you can do because you have already studied OS for 4 weeks back. You can do that 50 questions and that's just skimming through it. So you have the base ready, you have that cake ready, and this most asked questions are just that cherry on top of that cake that is going to make you stand out of the crowd, that is going to help you answer questions, because that is actually giving you a direction on topics which you have to focus. So one of my friends, she was interviewing for Deutsche Bank. Yeah, so that guy, he was interviewing for Deutsche Bank, and we had a talk 4 days before. So I asked him, I told him, I know you are not going to be able to, you know, cover this three subjects in 3 days. It's going to be very tough. Simultaneously, oops bhi karna hai, projects bhi samajhni hai, aur competitive coding bhi karna hai. So do one thing. Jo important topics hai, to jo most asked questions mein pata chalenge, just skim through it, unko samajh ke rakh. There's a high chance that might get in, you know, that might get asked in your interview. And when he went for that interview, usko wahi pucha gaya. Similarly, one of the guys who was interviewing for credit says he was sitting outside the interview office, and one day before he had a talk with me. So I told him, Geeks for Geeks pe OS ka last minute notes ka ek page hai. So what that guy did was, he was sitting outside and on his mobile, he was just scrolling through that OS notes. Usne 5-6 concepts aise hi dekh liye. He went inside and usse wahi question pucha gaya, and he got selected in credit sales. So those things happen. So what happens is, don't just do that most asked question. First, create your base. Create the fact that you understand what operating system is. Uske baad that happens that you don't recall everything. So what is important, you recall that. You will find those in most asked questions. And in my LinkedIn post, you can completely find that. Then aptitude is something I didn't prepare much for. I prepared it only once or twice. Itna nahi kiya tha, but... aptitude ke cheat sheets aate hai, 3-3 pages ke cheat sheets aate hai. I'm not sure if you guys are aware of. Google pe jaake sirf cheat sheet dalo aptitude ka, 3-page ka cheat sheet aata hai. Wo cheat sheet ko you just go through that cheat sheet. We are engineers, we are currently in our engineering. We understand basic formulas chalte kaise hai. That's what our core is. Hame samajh mein aati hai cheeze, logic lagane aata hai. That's what differentiates us from other people, right? So go through those. I'll say wo ek baar skim kar lo, tumhe pata chal jayega ki kaun se formulas hai. Similarly, एक बुक है आरएस अग्रवाल. आरएस अग्रवाल के अंदर देर आर हंड्रेड्स ऑफ एप्टीट्यूड टॉपिक्स, राइट? यू डोंट हैव टू डू दोस हंड्रेड्स ऑफ एप्टीट्यूड टॉपिक्स. पहले जाके तुम्हारे हिसाब से देख लो. जैसे व्हेन आई वाज देयर, आई अंडरस्टूड दैट यार टाइम इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट, वर्क इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट, डिस्प्लेसमेंट वाले क्वेश्चंस आर वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट, अपस्ट्रीम डाउनस्ट्रीम बोर्ड्स वाले क्वेश्चंस आर वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट. आई टेक दोस, आई वेंट टू दोस चैप्टर. चैप्टर के ऑन द फर्स्ट पेज ऑफ द चैप्टर देयर इज अ स्मॉल there's a small brief or there's a small summary of all the formulas which are required. That hardly takes you 15-20 minutes to go through that summary, and 15-20 multiply by, like, let's say you're covering 10 topics, right? So 150 minutes, roughly 2.5 hours ke andar you can get done with your aptitude. You have to, and simultaneously just go on Career Cup, Sand Foundry, look at a few problems here and there. But I would suggest, don't completely divert your attention towards aptitude, because that is a part of it, that is not the entire coding or, you know, interview round. So there are some basics of virtual interviews. If you haven't not given it, you need to understand what the environment is. You actually are coding something and you're looking down, that actually is going to show you, that show the interviewer that you're a little scared to, you know, look into the camera and explain things. I'm also practicing right now. Most of the times, I think I'm also looking down. I'm also looking at the screen. But try to look at the camera. Okay. Get habitual with Google Doc. That's what I mentioned. The reason I'm putting it again, because people are going to still go on LeetCode and solve problems. What you have to do is go to LeetCode, get that problem statement, paste it into a Google Doc, solve that problem statement there itself without even seeing what the definition or the function definition of that problem is. You have to write your function definition. In an interview, they don't give you a function definition. You have to write what the return type is, what the function name is, what are the parameters you're going to take in. Do that. Once you're done with it, put that back onto LeetCode and see how, what kind of code you've written. You'll realize how much mistakes you make. And from there, your coding skills will start developing. There is something called as touch typing, that is looking at the camera and typing things. It takes time, but that really helps you type faster, really helps you interact with the interviewer when you are coding as well. So that clearly, you know, that's something which the interviewer wants. He wants you to interact with him. He doesn't want you to just type on looking downwards. And all these things are something which major of the crowd is not able to do. You try to do that. You try to make that difference. And that's where talking to the camera comes. I'm also learning it, right? I mean, it takes time, so because I have to refer the PPT. I'm also looking out there, but I'm also trying. And there is one big issue which happens in your virtual interviews off campus. Mein ye hamesha hota hai. Off campus mein, the point is virtual interviews hote hai. Virtual interviews ke andar, there are latency issues. Your bandwidth is less, or someone else, unka bandwidth less hai, aapka bandwidth less hai. आप कुछ बोलते हैं वो 2 सेकंड के बाद वापस जाता है. ही सेइंग समथिंग दैट कम्स आफ्टर 2 सेकंड टू यू एंड दैट क्लैश थिंग्स हैपन. सो देयर आर टू थिंग्स यू डू. आइदर यू वेट कंप्लीटली और आइदर यू कंप्लीट योर सेंटेंस. डोंट जस्ट स्पीक अ हाफ सेंटेंस एंड लीव इट देयर. दैट क्रिएट्स अ वेरी बिग प्रॉब्लम फॉर हिम एंड दैट इज क्वाइट डिस्टर्बिंग बिकॉज यू हैवंट कंप्लीटेड योर सेंटेंस एंड यू आर ऑल्सो नॉट लिसनिंग टू वट ही हैज टू से. सो जस्ट आस्क द इंटरव्यू पोलाइटली. Can you clearly hear me and am I in sync with the Google Doc I'm typing on? If he says yes, you are in sync with it, then you are good to go with it. If he says you're not, then try to understand that there's a 2 second delay which is happening when you are speaking and when that thing is reaching the interviewer. Now, biggest important thing, I think, competitive coding questions solve kaise karte. I'm seriously, this is something I think way different than what you do on lead code. Okay, I'm talking about interviews. I'm not talking about lead code, code chef competitions. Your interviewer comes with a problem which is guaranteed to be miss, you know, it's not going to be very clear. Usme bahut sare assumptions honge. It's pretty much unclear about what problem statement that is. So you have to, first thing is, reiterate the entire question and tell him, this is what I understood from your question. Are we both on the same track? He will tell you whether what you understood is right or wrong. Let him know your assumptions. If you're saying that you, I'll tell you what the basic assumption is. He's given you a stack and he's asking you to perform some operations on a stack. And in the example, he has just given you numbers which are positive. You need to ask him, can I have negative numbers? He's asking you to find a sum of, or find the multiplication of an array. You have to ask him whether zero would be present or not. Whether the size of that array would be empty or not. What is the constraints on the space complexity I have to use? What is the time constraints you are giving me? That usually comes after the algorithm. But at every step, you need to specify what are your assumptions. Anything which is not specified by the interviewer and you are assuming has to be told to the interviewer that this is what I'm assuming. I'm assuming, let's say for example, you are given a question, convert a tree into a doubly linked list. There are two options. You can either convert the same tree into the doubly linked list in place using same nodes, or you can create a separate doubly linked list. You need to specify and ask him, which one do I have to do? He's not going to tell you. And if you write a code wherein you are using a new doubly linked list and you're done with the code, and he says, no, I was not expecting this. I didn't understood your algorithm. Why are you using an extra space? Why are you not converting the same tree into a doubly linked list? That creates a problem. So before even moving to your algorithm, specify your assumptions. Next thing, you came up with a brute force solution. You came up with an optimized solution, or you came up with an efficient solution. What you have to do is first explain him the brute force solution. It's not always expected to code it, but you are expected to specify that initially you thought ye n square mein honga, usko dp mein convert karke ye order of n mein hone wala, isme space bhi n square hi lagenga, but specify all those things. Once you are done with your algorithm, your interviewer ask him, well, should I proceed forward to code? If he agrees that the algorithm is correct, the time complexity is correct, then move forward to code. Biggest mistake people do is once their code is done, they leave it. And that is the biggest mistake I think people do. They just leave it. They don't dry run it. They don't test it. They don't debug it. What you have to do is you have to bring out test cases. Like I said, criticize your own algorithm. Try to find out bugs in your own algorithm. Try to dry run it. Take an example. Don't just take an example given by him. Generate your own algorithm. In few of my interviews, I actually came up with some examples which are interviewer also didn't know about, and he was pretty happy knowing that I was able to come up with some test cases. So that's where you actually show those things, you know, that's where you actually stand out, because everyone is going to come and code and show it to them. There's something that should sparkle inside you. And there's something that should stand out from everyone, and it has to be present in you. So do that. And once you know that, okay, I've given him a brute force solution, I've given him an optimized solution, I did it using sorting. Let's do one thing. Once my test case is done, once my everything is done, let me suggest him an alternate approach. He might not ask you to code it. He might ask you to code it. It's up to them, depending on the time. But tell him that I can do this using the priority queue as well. I can do it in a heap as well. I can heapify the array itself. Because I'm only concerned about the top k elements, I'll put it into a priority queue. No need to sort and go for the first k elements. You do that. And I'm again repeating this. Try and record yourself. How do you explain a coding question? And you will realize where do you stand. I realized it in my final year, and that's where I changed. That's where I switched to different things. When you are writing code, modularization is very important. Let's take an example. Let's say, for example, you are reverse, the interviewer gives you a code, reverse a list in groups of k. So your main function is reverse k linked list. This is your main function. Inside your main function, there is one sub part where you are actually going to reverse a list linked list of size k. So you don't write that code in itself. Don't write that code into the main program which you have written. Write that reverse ka code, reversing a basic k size linked list into another generic function. Be dependent on that generic function. That I have written a code. Any input to that particular generic function is guaranteed to give me an output. If you want to understand it in non-technical term, you have three different, there are starters, main course, and desserts in your buffet. So you have to write your starters function in such a sense that it is going to get you those starters. It is guaranteed to work for any input you provide. Write a generic function and be dependent on that. Similarly for main course and similarly for desserts. And then you compile all three of them and bring it to the buffet. That's what I mean by modularization of code. Divide your code into parts, make it reusable. That's where you can do that. So, and because I think this is the most important thing people are actually looking out for. They are in their interview, they're giving their off-campus interviews, and they're stuck. You're not able to solve that competitive coding question. What exactly would you do in that case? So first thing is, what a human brain does, it actually takes that thing, it follows some certain instructions on it, and it goes and get the output. You similarly have to build that algorithm for it. So take that input, note down micro steps your brain is taking to get to the output. Okay, first step is I'm sorting the array. Second step is I'm actually collecting all the even elements. Third step is I'm going to collect all the odd elements. Fourth step is sum of second and third. So dry run edge cases, dry run base cases, that's where you will find how to devise your initial algorithm. Now, the next thing is you actually have a tendency to work with examples which are given by the interviewer. You bring out test cases that is covering your maximum conditions. Let's say, for example, tumne 5 if else likha hai. Bring up a test case that is pretty unique, that is going into a condition that's actually failing your algorithm. That's where you realize what changes are needed in your algorithm. Next is properties of data structures fitting the situation. Like I gave that example of heap, right? So initially I was doing it with sorting. Now I understand that sorting to kar rahe ho, but hume sirf k elements chahiye. N is 1 lakh. I'm only concerned about top 5 maximum elements. So let's go for a heap. Let's use the property of heap that it keeps maximum on the top. Use that thing. Let's use the property of a stack that when you put something into it, it removes the last one first. Let's use property of a queue that whatever you put into it, that is going to get used first. So if you're stuck, go back to your data structures. Okay, can I use array in this situation? No, it's not possible. Can I use stack in this situation? No, it's not possible. Can I use queue? Yeah, partially queue fits. Can I use a priority queue? Yeah, that also fits here. Okay, let's go ahead with priority queue. So that's where you give your brain a direction to think in where you can possibly find the solution. Then using templates, I explained this. Like I said, try to relate that particular question to any templates or any standard concepts you actually have solved. And the fifth one being, so let's take for example, in 1 second, there are 10 raised to 8 operations which your compiler can perform, right? So, and if your input size is 10 raised to 3, then you can go for n square, because 10 raised to 3 ka square jo hota hai, wo 10 raised to 6 hota hai. That is within 1 second. Now, if your input size is 10 raised to 5, you cannot go and perform an n square algorithm. So, tumhe wahan pe pata chalta hai ki n log n ho sakta hai, order of n ho sakta hai, ya order of log n hota hai. So, at that particular point, you understand ki what exactly the algorithm is asking me to do. Is it asking me to divide the subproblem? Is it asking me to iterate through it in order of n 3-4 times? Or is it actually just a search in log of n? That's where you understand what the problem statement wants you to solve. Now, DP ke andar ye bahut baar hota hai. What you actually do is you find out recursive solutions which are actually repeating themselves. This repetition of work is where you can optimize the solution. You came up with the brute force solution, the interview is happy with you, but how will you exactly optimize it? So optimization ke liye, you have to find repetition of work. Aisa kaun sa place hai jahan pe bar bar main I'm doing the same work, I'm actually computing the same thing again. That's where you can, I think, optimize your entire code. Reverse engineer. People usually have a tendency to get the input and go to the output. Let's say binary search karna hai. So I'll just give another example. Input se output jaate. So what happens is you try to reverse engineer the problem. Take the output. Try to find the search space. Ki ye output ka range kitna hai. Okay, mujhe pata chala output ka range 50 se leke 100 tak hai. Uska midpoint nikalo, 75 pata chala. Try to check whether 75 ke liye the input is satisfying the conditions or not. अगर वो सेटिस्फाइंग कर रहा है तो 75 के नीचे के लिए भी करेगा. अगर वो सेटिस्फाई नहीं कर रहा है तो सॉरी 75 के लिए कर रहा है तो 75 के ऊपर के लिए भी करेगा. 75 तो 100 वाले स्लॉट में जाना है तुम्हें. अगर वो सेटिस्फाई नहीं कर रहा है तो 75 से लेकर 50 वाले स्लॉट में जाना है. सो बेसिकली रिवर्स इंजीनियर, गो फ्रॉम योर आउटपुट टू योर इनपुट. एंड वन मोर थिंग, एवरी प्रॉब्लम विद द इंटरव्यूअर इज गिविंग यू, ही हिमसेल्फ सॉल्वड इट, राइट? समवन हैड सॉल्वड इट, समवन ब्रॉट इट. Someone had written it somewhere on the compiler. Unhone pure test case banate. That problem is solvable. This really helps you motivationally boost yourself when you're actually stuck in into a competitive coding interview. Off campus mein bahut important hota hai to stand out through your resume. Off campus placements mein kya hota hai ki everyone is eligible. Let's say for example, agar third year ke liye internship, yeah, let's say for example, final year ke liye, full time ke liye, Goldman या फिर गूगल का जो अभी I'll tell you that गूगल का भी हायरिंग होगा जुलाई के अंदर 2021 grads, make sure you apply for that. 2021 के grads all over India से सब लोग apply करने वाले हैं. So how do you think you will stand out of the crowd? There you cannot just, because if you write HackerRank 5 star, there are many people with HackerRank 5 star. If you write CodeShelf, there are many people with that as well now. So how exactly this tech and open source helps you there? And how exactly competitive coding helps you in your entire process. So technical things and open source contributions jo hote hain, jaise maine GSoC nahi kiya, I'll be very frank with you, maine GSoC nahi kiya, I was never into open source, but this is something I'll realize later, that's why I'm not going to speak much on that, but I'll be very truthful to you guys. So jo technical or open source ya projects bolenge hamare jo projects hote hain, ये तुम्हें, these actually help you to get shortlisted for an interview. These come on your resume. This makes your profile stand out from other people. And when you speak about competitive coding, OOPs and fundamentals of CS, that is going to crack your interview. So when people say, you know, you don't need to do tech and open source, that's absolutely wrong. And when people say you don't need to do competitive coding, or you don't need to do problem solving, you don't need to understand fundamentals of CS, that's again a problem. So you need to maintain a balance between both of them. Now coming to where you can learn and apply about tech and open source. So you don't need to externally go and do a React.js course, okay? Stop that thing. I mean, that's what students do. They pick up AI. They are not even making a project in AI, and they just दे जस्ट थिंक यार इंडस्ट्री में बहुत फैंसी लग रहा है, दिस इज गोइंग टू गेट मी अ सुपर्ब जॉब, दैट डजंट गेट यू. यू हैव टू सी वॉट इज इन लाइन विथ योर प्रोजेक्ट्स, वॉट इज इन लाइन विथ योर इंटर्नशिप्स विच यू आर डूइंग, एंड वॉट इज इन लाइन विद द हैकाथॉन्स यू आर अप्लाइड टू, एंड देयर यू यूज दैट थिंग, देयर यू एक्चुअली ओके आई एम इन डूइंग अ प्रोजेक्ट विच हैज अ फुल स्टैक वेब डेवलपमेंट, दैट्स वेयर आई एम गोइंग टू लर्न रिएक्ट. आई डोंट हैव दैट मच टाइम कि यार पहले रिएक्ट पढ़ लेते 6 महीने, उसके बाद एंगुलर पढ़ लेते, उसके बाद आयोनिक पढ़ लेते. नो दैट्स दैट्स नॉट पॉसिबल, एंड इवन इफ यू हैव ऑल दोज थिंग्स यू आर नॉट गोना क्रैक योर इंटरव्यू, बिकॉज यू डोंट नो हाउ टू सॉल्व बेसिक प्रॉब्लम्स, बेसिक फंडामेंटल्स नहीं आते आपको. आपको ये नहीं पता कि थ्रेड्स चल कैसे रहे, आपको ये नहीं पता ऑब्जेक्ट ओरिएंटेड प्रोग्रामिंग हाउ इज दिस ऑब्जेक्ट्स हैविंग इनहेरिटेंस क्या है, एब्स्ट्रैक्शन क्या है, एनकैप्सुलेशन क्या है, द बेसिक प्रॉपर्टीज ऑफ डेटा, यू नो ऑब्जेक्ट ओरिएंटेड प्रोग्रामिंग, यू आर नॉट अवेयर ऑफ दैट. So that might create a problem for you. And similarly, when you speak about where to learn competitive coding, oops, fundamentals of CS, you have Geeks for Geeks. There are various algorithms written there. You can even follow different lists. And I also showed you through what phase I went and how actually I learned this competitive coding and everything, or problem solving ability. Let me be very clear with that. And for your interviews, LeetCode is a site which is pretty much having questions which are mostly asked in interviews. But whereas if you go into CodeChef and something, it's good to go. It's absolutely no worries with that. It's absolutely okay if you, you know, practice on any platform. It's about problem solving ability. But LeetCode has questions which are more towards interviews, and CodeChef, CodeStar have, sorry, CodeChef and all those kind of questions are there, which are more towards competitions, like you know. हैकर कप या फिर वो कोड जैम, किक स्टार्ट एंड ऑल दोस काइंड ऑफ थिंग. सो यू कैन प्रेफर लीड कोड, बट इट्स अप टू यू इफ यू वॉन्ट टू डू दैट एज वेल फॉर योर प्रॉब्लम सॉल्विंग अबिलिटी, दैट रियली हेल्प्स यू. लाइक आई सेड, हाउ मच डू यू वॉन्ट टू लर्न टेक स्टैक? यू लर्न एज मच एज रिक्वायर्ड. यू वॉन्ट टू डू सम ओपन सोर्स कॉन्ट्रीब्यूशन, लर्न फॉर दैट. यू वॉन्ट टू डू सम प्रोजेक्ट, लर्न फॉर दैट. डोंट जस्ट थिंक ऑफ दैट आई लर्न रिएक्ट एंड एम गोना गेट एन इंटर्नशिप एट गूगल. That doesn't happen. In fact, in Google, when I gave my interviews at Google, it was completely problem solving and fundamentals and my projects. It was not a single thing about my tech stack was asked. I mean, they just discussed the project, not even questions on tech stack. So that's one thing. You do tech and open source to stand out of the crowd. You perform. You actually build super awesome resumes. Super awesome projects, and when you are building these projects, make sure they are products. Don't do a sentiment analysis. Let's take this example. Don't do a sentiment analysis project which is just on Python console. Do a sentiment analysis project wherein you are building a replica of Amazon e-commerce website. I know you're not going to build it to that scalable level, but build an e-commerce website and ask your friends to actually put in reviews there. Connect your backend wherein you have implemented the sentiment analysis ka Python ka code, connect it to your front end, or use Django and do that connection and everything, build that up. And there you do sentiment analysis and then show that in your interview. That you built a website e-commerce and the main feature or the main heart of your website was that you performed sentiment analysis on the customer reviews which the website gets. That's how how you build projects. You build a product. You don't just build anything that is inside your one of your old folders from past 7 months. You don't do that. You get it live. I couldn't do that. That's what I learned after my engineering, that yeah, I could have done good projects. I could have deployed some website. I didn't get a chance to do that. But right now I'm doing it in my company. I'm writing code which goes into production. So I wish I did that when I had a chance. I wish I could have applied to GSOC. I wish I could have done open source. I wish I could have understand these concepts like what is GitHub. One more thing is project tracking. I'm not sure. No one does that, I'm pretty sure. You need to set project tracking in the sense you need to set every week's deadline that you have to cover so and so every week. Become a leader in your group if no one is ready to take that. Become that leader and try to divide it. Okay, try to divide the work. Try to actually lead the entire project. And when it comes to competitive coding, how much you should do, I think starting from your first year, second year, whenever you start, it's a consistent effort throughout your engineering, which is actually developing your problem-solving ability. There's no such thing as 400 questions karne hai, 500 questions karne hai, 1,000 questions karne hai. I am also learning competitive coding. I'm also doing it constantly. whenever I get time, I connect on weekends with my juniors. I teach them data structures, they teach me back, and we have a good time. So it's that way. Now, this is where your off-campus placements versus internships come into picture. That's pretty much the important part. I'm again repeating this thing. You might get that opportunity. Don't cry for the fact that you're not getting an opportunity. If you're in your third year, you have 1.5 years remaining to graduate. If you're in your final year, you still have 4 months. You are going to get an opportunity. Now, it's not about getting that opportunity. Rather, it's about whether you crack that opportunity or not. People get opportunities. That's not an issue. The issue is where you don't crack it. Because ask yourself, how many times it has happened that you went to an interview, which was an opportunity? It's happened with me. I went to Google, I gave onsites there. I gave like 7 rounds. I went to the final techno HR, that's part of that entire process. And I got rejected. That's where I realized it's not about saying that yaar, Google mera interview ko nahi le raha hai. But it's rather about jab wo leta hai, whether I'm able to crack it or not. That's what is important. So internship, so whatever I told before this is highly, highly important. Try to get as much as you can. Internships actually hote kya hai? This is one of the definitions which the CEO of one of my companies which I was working with, he mentioned this. An internship is an extended interview, and I really loved the definition, what he said. You have 3 types, summer, semester, and year long. And there are direct placements, wherein the company comes on that day, it offers you, takes your interview, and next year you have to join that company. And there's PPO rate. Let's talk one at a time about this. So summer internships are usually 2 months, May se leke July tak hote. What you have to do is, you have to first see ki May se July ke baad, when do they give that offer letter? Even if it's off campus, you have to see when do they give that offer letter. You have to get that in your mind ki offer letter kab dene wale. Similarly for semester and year long. Year long maybe you have to make sure, go to such a company for an internship where you actually are sure that you might get a PPO. Let's take for example, you're not sure you're not going to get an PPO, but you're not getting internships as well. So what you do is you go for a year-long internship. That's absolutely fine. You will learn what the corporate life is. You will understand what it is. But at the same time, you don't stop struggling for your interviews. You don't stop giving interviews off campus. You don't stop trying for big companies. You don't stop trying for companies like Credit Suisse. You don't stop trying for companies like Morgan Stanley or normal NVIDIA. Yeah, jo bhi XYZ companies aati hai, aapke campus pe nahi aati hai, toh off campus mein bahut hai. I'll tell you where to find them. You try for that. And don't, people have a very big misconception. I guess every one of you is having the first one. Yeah, direct placements aayenge na, tab I will crack it. Abhi internship ke liye jaane ki zarurat nahi hai. You are not sure for the fact that, like, if I ask you today, kal I'll bring, tomorrow I give you an opportunity at my company, let's say for example, Credit Suisse, you get an interview, I refer you tomorrow, will you be able to crack it? Can you give me 100% guarantee that you are able to crack it? No, you cannot say. So why are you saying that you won't sit for internships and someday down the line you'll get a placement, direct placement, when you're not even sure that you're not prepared that self? I wouldn't make that mistake. I never left companies just because wo year long the, semester wale the, ya internship wale the. Never do that. This is the first misconception, that I'll skip the internships and get a superb direct placement. The second thing is, I need to get an internship only to get a direct place, to get placed into a company. That's also not true. It's actually your planning. How do you look at things? If you want to go for a master's, you can find some companies which don't give PPO but have a superb research internships being carried out. You can go for those companies. So you need to plan these things. And the PPO rate is very important. I see some companies where they hire 20 interns and they are just giving you the PPO to one or two. Don't sit and hope that you are going to be that 1 or 2%. If you are excellent, it's your luck. It's something you've earned. Excellent. That's very good. But don't be dependent on that for 5 months. 5 months of your summer internship and you're dependent on the fact that, 5 months of your semester off-campus internships and you're dependent on the fact that they'll give me a PPO out of 20 people. If you get it, that's absolutely cool. But if you don't get it, that's a problem. So in those 5 months, you don't stop looking for placements. You don't stop looking for off-campus. And that's where the PPO rate comes in picture. You actually have to sit down with your friends, sit down with someone you trust, sit down with people who have done this and go through what your plan is for your final year or your third year and your final year, or if you are in your second and the first year, sit down and ask people, what should I do that will actually create an impact when I am graduating? If you're going for masters, you should have a different plan. If you're going for placements, you should have a different plan. If you're going for GATE, you should have a different plan. If you're going for startups, you should have a different plan. If you're going for government jobs, you should have a different plan. So this entire thing varies from individual to individual. Some people like semester internships and they're not concerned about the PPO, so they just go and take that semester internship. Some people are concerned about the PPO. Yeah, I'm my family is not going to finance me for going to master. Like it was the case with me. My family couldn't finance it. So I even tried to apply, I couldn't get it. I couldn't get the loan. So that's one thing. So I have to look at summer internships wherein I get the PPO at earliest as possible, or wherein I look at semester internships which have the highest PPO rate. Now, this is the slide I guess everyone's waiting for. I'll go through each one of them. This is something I've appeared for most of them. I've not appeared for a few of them. That's where I actually showed it to my juniors and they went out and gave interviews here. They are also preparing. So kisi ka hota hai crack, kisi ka nahi hota, that's fine. Credit Suisse, I guess more than 9 to 10 interns at Credit Suisse know me personally, and I've guided them for Global Coding Challenge. I mean, not for the challenge itself, but rather ki baad mein how interviewing kaise karte, the same thing which I just told every one of you. So Credit Suisse happens every year in October to November. Okay, you will be given 9 problems. Okay, you are given 20 days. This year it was given 20 days. In those 20 days, you have to finish those 9 problems, and you have different. If you go and look at the rules, you'll understand what I'm saying. Like for submitting in 5 languages, you are going to get some good points. If you submit it for submitted the fastest or the shortest code, gets good points. So Credit Suisse definitely hires interns from there. They also hire full time, but hiring full time from Coded Suisse and Global Coding Challenge, or mine was Coded Suisse, they changed it to Global Coding Challenge. In all of these 11 which I've just mentioned, the hiring depends on the requirement, what the requirement comes in. So in 2019, they 2020 sorry 2019 they hired full-time employees through Global Coding Challenge, but in 2020 they only hired interns through Global Coding Challenge. So it depends on the requirement. That's something which you can't do anything about. Today, I guess it's March 20th. I am telling you right now. I am telling you right now. In July, or in let's say July, August ka jo span hai, 15 July ke baad, Google opens its full-time opportunities. And that's applicable for everyone. There's no thing as tier three, and there's nothing like that. Put up a good resume, show that you have done some good projects, show your profile stands out, measure your work which you have done. I'll tell you what are the stages in that. If you're an intern, there are two coding there is one coding round which is having 2 questions. You've got 1 hour. In the second one, then you proceed to the interview rounds. You have 2 interview rounds. There's one interview round wherein you are asked 1 or 2 questions. Then again, there's 45 minutes second interview. There's again 1 or 2 questions. So that's for interns. So within, I guess, 4 questions, you can crack your Google internship, which is your always dream. Those, if you are able to solve those 4 questions, not just solve, explain them, explain your thought process, follow all those things I told you, that really helps you. Then the next one is for full times. There's one coding round and there are 4 on-site interviews and 1 non-tech interview for a full time. So when I gave for a full time back in January, I had given for Google Canada, I didn't give for India one. So I first gave my coding round. Then they called me up for a telephonic interview. So what happens is people from different parts of the world, any developer from any Google office, it just directly connects with you. And that's when he gave me the first coding question. So initially I solved those 2 coding questions in 1 hour. I cleared through the coding round. Then I went to the first round. I cleared that. Then I was called on site to Canada, but visa rejected and all those story, matlab wo ek alag story hai. Visa got rejected, so I had to give it virtually. But trust me, it's so awesome. I even have that invitation letter from Google. It clearly mentions for Afan Sheikh, and then it says Google India, sorry, Google Canada invites Afan Sheikh, so and so. They book a 5-star hotel for you. They book your cab. Everything is there. That's super awesome. I mean, that's an achievement in life, even to get that invitation letter. Then I gave my 4 virtual on-site interviews. I solved all of them, but that's when I realized, I know it's not just about solving. It's about explaining your thought process. It's about your entire profile. It's about how good you are at communicating your thoughts. So that comes for Google. I remember it was in my 3rd year. There was Microsoft internship, which came around November, December end. All of my friends got a chance to go for this internship. And I was sitting there crying, saying, "Yaar, mujhe abhi tak wo link hi nahi aaya." And it was so, I don't know why, but the HR never sent me that link. Off campus, mein all over world, India hua tha. I never got that link. I even checked my spam. And as a fun fact, I even checked my Facebook ka bhi messages, check kare ke idhar kuch aata hai kya. Wo email dono ka same tha. And like, bahut funny hua tha. But at the end of the day, they didn't even give me. I mean, theek hai, wo, that happens. But many of my friends got it. So you should try that. Microsoft ka ek hota hai. But that varies from year to year. Hamare time pe liya tha. Uska 2020 mein bhi unhone liya tha. But 20, abhi wale batch ke liye unhone nahi liya tha. So that's one thing you should look out for. Twitter ka, go to Twitter University Recruiting. There's a, actually search on Google Twitter University Recruiting. They have their own page. Subscribe to it. They actually send out mails to you when they start their university hiring. So APAC region ka ek hiring hota hai, Asia Pacific ka. Try for that. मैंने जब try किया था, I think हाँ, मुझे coding round दिया था, मुझे 3 questions दिए थे, I cleared that. Coding round के बाद they didn't call me back. I think मेरा profile उतना अच्छा नहीं था तभी. It was my final year, I guess. So that happens. Amazon, I have given twice 2 coding rounds at Amazon. So initial one was pool campus होता है states के across. Mumbai India, Mumbai Pune का एक pool campus हुआ था. Your TPOs will tell you when this pool campus happens. Or on LinkedIn, you can find it. I'll tell you how to search on LinkedIn as well. This happened in November, and there was one coding round, 2 questions, 28 MCQs. I solved those 2 questions. I was able to clear that 28 MCQs. But later I realized ki, kisi ko bhi Amazon ne nahi bulaya baad mein. And the second time in January I gave. So Amazon called me to Bangalore, but due to some personal emergency, I was not able to go to Bangalore. So I had to cancel my interview. So they called me twice. Second time I had again given the same coding round. Questions different there. So wo bhi solve kiya, 28 MCQs wapis se the, wo bhi different there, solve that. But I was not able to go to Bangalore for an on-site. That's where I missed it. I gave D-Shaw, I'll be very frank, this is a tough coding round. I was not able to clear it. I even gave it for my friend. So पहले वाले में मैंने 2 ब्रूट फोर्स किया था, 2 या 3 questions थे, आई गेस. तो आई थिंक मैंने 3 ब्रूट फोर्स किया था एंड उसमें से सिर्फ 1 ही पास हुआ था. फॉर माई फ्रेंड आई डिड 3 में से, आई गेस आई कम्प्लीटेड 2 ऑफ देम, दोनों पास हो गए, थर्ड वाला पास नहीं हुआ. सो डीशा हायर्स ड्यूरिंग दिस टाइम, आई गेस यू कैन चेक द करियर साइट नाउ. आई एम नॉट श्योर इफ इट्स ओपन राइट नाउ, बट आई क्लियरली रिमेंबर आई गॉट दिस अपॉर्चुनिटी टू इंटरव्यू विद डीशा मार्च एंड जून में, इंटर्न या फुल टाइम के लिए. द रीजन आई वॉज नॉट एबल टू गो थ्रू ऑल ऑफ दीज इंटरव्यूज और यू नो ग्रैब ऑफर्स वॉज बिकॉज आई वॉज लर्निंग, आई वॉज इन माई लर्निंग स्टेज. आई डिडंट, नो वन वॉज देयर टू टेल मी यू नीड टू डू दीज थिंग्स इन योर इंटरव्यू. इट वॉज ऑल रैंडम. इट वॉज लाइक इंटरव्यू देने के आने के बाद पता चलता था क्या करना चाहिए था इंटरव्यू के अंदर. एंड थ्रू आर फाइनल ईयर आई रियलाइज वॉट आर द डिफरेंट थिंग्स रिक्वायर्ड फॉर एन ऑफ कैंपस इंटरव्यू. आई वॉज लकी इनफ टू यू नो क्रैक द ग्लोबल कोडेड स्विस, बट स्टिल. Amazon also hires for women of world of women. That's only for females. I think since I'm giving a speech at Cummins today, please watch out for this one. They're not concerned about which college you are from. April and January mein ye usually hota hai. Wow ke andar. I think I've shown that to 3 or 4 of my friends and they've given interviews there. I'm not sure if they were able to crack it or not. Wo hota hai, unko practice bhi lagti hai, right? So Amazon Wow ka bhi hota hai. That's specifically for females. The competition is less. And you know, what happens is they don't care from where you come. They only care about how good you perform in your interview. So have that in mind. Goldman Sachs. Every August Goldman Sachs ka hiring hota hi hota hai. This is an off-campus opportunity. But yahan pe sirf ek chota sa clause hai. They ask verbal and they ask aptitude thing. I was not able to solve that. Let's be very frank. Goldman Sachs में ऐसे हुआ था. तो वो कोडिंग राउंड में आई कुडंट क्लियर दैट्स वेरी मच इन द बिगनिंग व्हेन आई स्टार्टेड लर्निंग कॉम्पिटिटिव कोडिंग तब का था वो. सो उन्होंने मैथ्स भी पूछा था तो टोटली कुछ आता नहीं था मैथ्स वगैरह का. सो रिजेक्ट हो गया. बट बाद में पता चला कि यार ये हर साल आते हैं और हम पिछले साल इंटर्नशिप के लिए भी अप्लाई कर सकते हैं. बट हमारे इट्स लाइक वी डिडंट न्यू अबाउट दिस. वी डिडंट नो दैट गोल्डमैन गिव्स एन अपॉर्चुनिटी. व्हेन इट केम इन द फाइनल ईयर व्हेन आई स्टार्टेड व्हेन इट केम टू माय कॉलेज college message aaya tha that such and such hiring is going on in Goldman. That's when I realized, oh, this happens for interns as well. I missed an opportunity back in my third year. So none of you guys should miss this opportunities in your third year as well. PayPal is also hiring full time, basically 2021 grads ke liye. They had opened in September this year itself. I had shown it to many of my juniors. Then there's Codenation. This is very good level competitive coding. This is pretty awesome. I tried it once because only one time I could, that was in my final year, I got to know about it. I was able to do one and a half problem, I guess. I don't remember that much. But yeah, Codenation was that way. Then there's Morgan Stanley. I didn't give that. One of my friends gave it in October for an internship. So Morgan Stanley is also a pretty good company. They pay around 14-15 ka to milta hai CTC. So these are some off-campus opportunities. I've written the months where they actually come in. But I don't think you need to take a screenshot of this. I'll tell you how will you get notified. So everyone has that question. How come that person knows ki yaar off-campus ho ka raha hai? How do you know that PCCU pe off-campus ho raha hai? So first thing, if you go to Google, just type this thing, off-campus India. And you'll find hundreds of websites. You'll find those websites are having different Telegram and WhatsApp groups. Basically, join those WhatsApp groups. They'll notify you when new hiring come up. This is something which is started recently. I guess it started in 2019, 2020. They continuously post different openings which are, which are coming out. I don't know how do they do that. They monitor things or something like that. But these guys have actually, from here I got to know Amazon is hiring. And that's where I gave my coding round from here only. I applied and I got my coding round. So it was a Telegram channel. So you can find it. Just keep and join and keep it. Take 15 minutes out of in your day and just skim through it. You find something, okay, these guys are looking for internships. I'm in third year. I can go there. Do that. These guys are looking for final year students, 2021 grads, explicitly likha hai, I should go there. What you do is you go to YouTube or go to LinkedIn pe bhi bahut milenge, but try to replicate process. Why? What I mean to say, replicate what I did. I went through Codeitsuis. You go through now Global Coding Challenge. Try to replicate the process. Replicate the process in the sense, try to find people who got off-campus placements. You don't need to actually ping them and ask, aapko kaise mila? Everyone is pretty, pretty active on LinkedIn today. They want to post what they did. I also post that. So go to those LinkedIn handles and see how did they get into those companies. You'll get to know which hackathons are there. Make a list of all those things. I'm not sure, but my alumni network is good enough. You also have to. So what you do is, one of your alumni is working in an XYZ company. You know your alumni are working at some companies. You can directly ping them on LinkedIn saying that I'm from your college only, and it would be grateful if you can refer me for so and so role. Or if they are not ready to refer you, you can even ask them, how exactly can I apply to your company? From where can I get a referral? From where do I get a chance to interview with you guys? That's what the alumni network is. There's one more thing you can do. I did it for myself. I did it for one of my friends. My friends are placed at good companies, and some of them are not having a proper, for me, credits is, it's always going to be official through the careers page. But in some small companies or some normal companies, there's no official careers page. They do have it, but even they call people and take interviews. So what I did was I asked one of my friends to refer some other friend into her company. So she referred it and that guy got an interview there. So what I exactly mean to say by alumni is, check out your alumni and see where they are working. And if possible, I mean, not just alumni in the sense, not just people who are 3-4 years into the company, rather people who have just graduated. So let's say, for example, nobody knows about, let's say, for example, it was 2019 going on and nobody knows about Codeutsuis. So what my juniors will do is they will look at the seniors. They will find someone like me. They'll ask me, how did you get into Codeutsuis? I will tell them, I got through this Codeutsuis. I'll tell them, now it's changed to Global Coding Challenge. You can find that in the coming October. Prepare for it, do these things and get into it. I can do that. So that's where your alumni network and contacting your seniors. You can also do one thing, which I'm not sure if anyone has done or not. TPO ke mails aate, I remember this. Placement officer sends out different mails. So you are in your third year. You don't know how, you don't know your seniors, where they are placed. You have no idea. LinkedIn is getting you crazy. You cannot find them out. Simply do one thing. Connect with one of your seniors and ask her that, can you send me a list of all the placements which are done in your batch? If she has it, well and good. If she doesn't has it, just ask her one thing. On your email, you might have get many recruiters. On your email, you might have get many mails from your placement officer that so-and-so people, congratulations, you are placed here. Congratulations, you are placed there. Can you take out your 15 minutes and help me get those names? You have to ask this to your senior. She will help you out to find out people who are actually placed in different companies. From there, you can make a complete list of people who are where they are placed, try to connect with them and see how these things work. Then I found out many recruiters on LinkedIn who are actually constantly posting about their company. If there's an hiring challenge, so let's say I'll tell you, how do you find them? In Google, I'm giving example because it's pretty much what everyone wants, right? So in Google, there's talent acquisition specialist. There's a staffing channel specialist. There's university recruiter. So you basically Google, you put this on your LinkedIn search. You go into the filter, select Google as your company and send out invitations to them. It's better to send out through a message. Not always just go and ask out a referral, okay? You can even talk about companies. Like recently, back in my final year, I talked with one of the Microsoft recruiters. I asked her how exactly grads are going, grads get a chance to interview with Microsoft. She said, Afan, I didn't ask her, can you refer me? Can you give me a job? No, I asked her, you are a university recruiter. I find you as a right person who only knows about what the hiring process is. So can you please explain me where and how can I find an opportunity to interview with Microsoft? So she said, we don't hire grads for the first 2 years. And after the second year, there are roles opening for grads. SE1 pe open hota hai. 1+ years ke liye hota hai ya 2+ years ke? I don't exactly remember that. So that's how I create a connection with her. I talked with her and she answered my queries. And that's how I know I don't need to now go to Microsoft employees and start pinging them, yeah, referral dedo. Because there's no job opening that is in line with my profile. So that's where recruiters help you out. You can politely message them. I know they don't reply back. I completely understand, okay? SNEA that I'm just throwing out some things on you. I have experienced it. People have ignored many messages, the recruiters and the Facebook guys and all those. Wo karte hai, that's absolutely fine. But if you send out to 10 people, there might be one or two who's going to reply. So stay connected to as much recruiters as you can. University recruiters, dundo, LinkedIn pe bahut milte hai. And go to YouTubers. YouTubers ne bahut, matlab aise list bana ke rakh diye, ye off-campus placement aise hua tha iska, usne ye experience share kiya hai. Waha se bhi pata chalenge. Like where exactly off-campus placements is going on. If you try this today itself, I'll tell you, you'll get more than 10 openings or 10 hirings which are currently going on. You might not be eligible for all of them. Not 10 of 10 would be for you. 7 might be for you. 3 might be something you're interested in. 4 might be something which are not paying you that much. 2 of them might be startup. So that happens. So LinkedIn is a very big platform. I'm not an expert on LinkedIn, but since you guys wanted to know where exactly I'm getting to know about these off-campus placements, it's pretty simple, I'll tell you. Go to LinkedIn, search hashtag hiring, search hashtag off-campus, click on the content tab. once you click on the content tab, you will find hundreds of pages. Okay, these LinkedIn pages are again continuously posting opportunities. The LinkedIn student network is highly, highly important. Right now, today, I'm not sure if you guys are on LinkedIn or not, but trust me, you need to be there. Today, I have around 2,800 connections or 2,900, not so sure. But in those 2,900 connections, I realized how people are getting opportunities in different off-campus. And that's where, if I was a junior, I would have followed the same process they did. So having a good student network is highly important, because your seniors, your juniors, or let's say, for example, tomorrow you end up into TCS or Infosys, Wipro, it's there's nothing wrong with those companies. The pay package is less as compared to big companies, but that's absolutely fine. But you're not satisfied now. You want to switch to a good product-based company, like or an investment bank like Credit Suisse, Deutsche Bank. So what you do is you have a very good, strong LinkedIn network. You know your junior has been placed into Credit Suisse, or your junior is placed into Deutsche Bank. You can simply ping him across and say, hey, I found this job ID. I'm an experienced person. I have 1 year of experience. And we are from the same college. Can you please refer me? Usually that also works. So people actually refer you. So that student network is highly important, because those are the ways you are going to actually know where those opportunities are hiding. Where exactly can you find them? And I found out, this is something I've been saying from a long time. And since I wanted you guys to, I just don't want to come and say things which are abstract. I actually wanted to give out content to you. You can go to these LinkedIn handles: Rahul Sharma, Arsh Goel, Gopinath S, Kushal Vijay. Arsh Goel is having his own YouTube channel as well. What these guys are doing, I'm not sure how they are doing it, but that's some amazing job they are doing. They are collecting opportunities, and every 1 week, every 10 days, they post out on LinkedIn these opportunities. They also mention which batch is applicable. And that's just amazing. I could even see Global Coding Challenge out there when it was back then. Many had done that. So these are the four people I know about. There might be many more, but start with these people. They actually post every week. And this is how you can, you know, create a complete way to crack an off-campus placement. I'm not saying that, let's be very frank, okay? It's not one day's work. It's not 1 month's work. It's not that the first attempt you make to an off-campus is going to give you an offer. It's a continuous attempt. Let's be very frank. People have done it for 1 year. People have done it for 6 months also. Some have got it in the first month itself. Some are still struggling to get it. So the only difference that's actually going to impact whether you get an off-campus or not, it's not the opportunities anymore, because it's not 2019 today, it's 2021. LinkedIn is full of opportunities. Off-campus sites are there, placements are there. YouTubers pe pura video bana ke bataya kaise placement lena hai off-campus. It's not about that. It's about the moment you get an opportunity, how do you convert into an offer? And people, there's one more thing I've heard a lot from people. They say, उसका लक था. Everyone say उसका लक था, इसलिए उसे easy questions आ गए. And some comments say it was his luck that it was my bad luck that I was not able to get the questions which I had solved, or got a question which I couldn't solve. The thing is simple. You work hard that much that even luck comes with you. You don't depend on luck. You work hard that much that luck comes with you. So do that. So I think that's it from my end, and I'm open to take any questions if you guys have, and I hope I've helped a lot. I mean, I wish I knew this when I started with my third year or fourth year placements. Okay.
Yes, you surely have helped us a lot. We'll quickly move to the Q&A session now. I'll see in the chat box if anyone has questions. So we have one question. Could you please recommend any YouTube channels?
Just 1 minute. So I think I'm not the right person to recommend any YouTube channels. I'll say why, because there are many of them. Taking a name of any single person might create a problem. But if you actually want a list of YouTube channels, go out to my LinkedIn profile There's an article on resources which I've mentioned. You'll find everything, right from object-oriented programming up to OS, CND, BMS, OOPS. Everything is there. I've linked in links. And I've mentioned 50 YouTubers, I guess, I think 50, who actually helped me out, who actually helped me, you know, learn these things from where I've collected my experience overall. So, yeah, you can have a look at that.
Okay, cool. We can do that. Yeah, so do we have any more questions, guys?
Feel free to ask any question. I mean, I'll be very frank with you. And if I don't know anything, I'll even tell you guys about that I'm unaware of that thing.
Wow.
Will you elaborate about curricula?
Okay. All right. So curricular in the sense is something achieve. When I say curricular, it's more about what you achieve, which is in line to your domain. Okay. In line to your domain in the sense you're applying for a software engineering role. Curricular is something which you are able to, let's say, for example, you cracked a hackathon, which is in line with your curricular in the sense, which is in line with your domain. So you developed a website that comes in your curricular. Now you're doing not developing a website, rather leading a project. That's non-technical and it's management. That comes into extracurricular or co-curricular. And the curricular section, usually I've kept it achievement section and extracurricular. So in that achievements, I put everything which I achieved with respect to my domain. I don't put things like I was able to manage a group of 80 DSE VIT members. Or I didn't put I've hosted around 20, 30 events at DSE VIT. I don't put that. I put things like, I'm the star performer. So I'll put that. That's something which I achieved. I was selected as in the top six from 3,500 students. So I put that. I put something like there was a hackathon in which our team stood first from 25 participating teams. I put that. So that comes in your curricular or achievement section. The achievement section is composed of the curricular. And on the other end, you're having your co-curricular. That's good to put because it shows you have that skills. Like, for example, if you interview with Amazon someday, you'll realize they have 14 leadership principles. So I think showing them that you can lead things, you can do some good things with a team of people, that really helps you out.
Okay, thanks for that answer.
Yep.
We have another question. Can you give some suggestions for non-CS background students for preparations?
All right, sure. Do you mean to say preparations for getting into CS, or do you mean to say for getting into non-CS domain?
Okay, so the participant has not mentioned that, but
okay.
I think it's for getting a placement, a good placement, even if you are a non-CS grad. I think it's about that.
Sure. So, I think you're talking about placements into IT companies. So I can answer that part. I cannot answer the part where you get a placement into the core, like ENTC or any mechanical or those kind of companies. So if you're looking at IT companies, you need to understand one thing, that if you perform good in an interview, they don't care from which branch you are. Okay. You need to first thing perform good from that. And for preparations, you need to double the efforts what those IT guys are taking. Let's be very frank with that, because they have it in their curriculum. They've been studying it from the second year, okay? And you haven't seen those things. So if they are putting in 2 hours a day, you need to put 4 hours a day. You connect across with them and ask them, what are the different things going on in your domain? Can you explain me about which project you guys are working on? Can you explain me what are the trending projects or what are the best projects of your class, of your department, which stood out? And you try to relate your, let's say, for example, it's ENTC is a non-CS. So in that case, you try to bring up some project which is intersecting these two branches. Try to come up with these things. I've seen people like, I'm not sure if you're aware of that guy, Rachit Jain. He's from ENTC, I guess. And that guy has cracked Amazon, right? So that's where I think, that's where it comes. It's not about whether you are from which background or which thing. It's rather how good you're performing in interviews. But there are some clauses, I'll tell you. Some companies don't hire from non-CSIT backgrounds. Like companies like VMware when it came to our placements, it never hired. So in those cases, don't just feel bad about it. Let's look at it from this angle. Branches which are not CS are worried and are complaining about not being in CS, not getting those opportunities. CS guys are complaining about not getting Microsoft, Google, Amazon at their campus. People who get Microsoft, Google, Amazon at their campus and are from Tier 3 are complaining for the fact that Microsoft, Amazon, Google is hiring only a bunch of people from here and they're taking many from IITs. So everyone is complaining. But let's take for an example, even if you are ready to, let's say even if Microsoft comes to you and it takes your interview tomorrow, are you that confident that you would crack? So instead of worrying for the fact that I'm from a non-CS background and I'm not getting those interviews, worry more about your preparation. And I think that's a good question that you asked, because usually it's about, we don't get that placement, what should we do? So I think, that's the point. You prepare well enough that if one opportunity comes to you, you crack that and you perform better than the CS guys. There's nothing of a difference. That's pretty simple. They got selected in a branch where the curriculum is that. There's nothing else. If they don't study, they're going to fail. If we don't study, if you guys don't study, you guys are not going to crack. It's very simple.
Yeah, that totally makes sense. So everything just boils down to the hard work that you put
in. Right.
Cool. So next question is, could you please elaborate about how to go for open source contributions?
Let's be very frank on this one. I haven't done any open source contributions, but I can definitely tell you where you can find these guys. I mean, go on YouTube. You have answer for everything. Today it's not about what to study or how to study. Today it's about whether you do it or not do it. So when you are telling me about open source contribution, let's be very frank with you. I haven't done that. I don't want to guide people on something I don't do. I don't like that. So I haven't done that, but definitely you can find, tons of videos on how to get GSOC, how to get that GirlScript wala hackathon, jo bhi bahut famous hua tha beech mein, kind of thing. So yeah, connect with people who have done that. And trust me, it's really, really going to change you as a software developer. I'll recommend this thing. I didn't put this in my slide. When I went into my engineering, I know I'm not talking about open source. The reason being, I'm not aware of it. So when I went in from my engineering to my job, I started learning things. I realized two things which I learned are very important, and I wish you guys do it in your project. First is project tracking, version control, GitHub वगैरह पे ये जो open source में ये लोग करते हैं. That's very, very helpful, right? You do that. And the second thing is, you don't just pitch in ideas, okay? That's what one of the quotes I wrote on LinkedIn. I mean, I'm not an influencer. I don't like, I think instead of listening 2 hours to someone motivating you, go out and solve two problems in those 2 hours. That's gonna benefit you more. Plan once, execute more. Plan only once, don't keep planning. That creates a very big problem for you. So that's about, I think, that's what I could say. It's not about whether how to do open source, how to go for it, rather it's whether you do it or not. That's what today it's about. YouTube has everything.
Correct. Yeah, that's totally true. So one of our participants has actually written that Code for a Cause is a good YouTube channel for open source. I completely agree. So the guy who runs that.
I guess it's Kunal Kushava, right?
Cracked GSOC in his first year, right?
Yeah, exactly. So you can learn from those guys. Those guys are pretty good in that. That's their domain, and I'd be happy to see you guys, go into GSOC and everything. That's pretty awesome.
Yeah, that's really awesome. So yeah, guys, check out Code for Cause. That guy is also awesome. So any more questions? We can take a couple of them, I guess. Are you okay with that?
Yeah, sure. I'm comfortable. It's my Saturday. I actually, on my weekends, I spend time with my juniors. That there are two things to it. One thing is, it helps me first, because what happens is when you are working in a company, you're not just gonna go and do data structures, but other end, you have to learn data structures. Otherwise you cannot write good code. You have to use them. They are in your daily work. I don't think I can code without data structures, but revisiting them, doing competitive coding, after 8 hours of work, it becomes pretty hectic. So when you connect across with your peers, these are friends of me who are very close to me. And we, you know, just connect. I teach them about data structures, how I learned them. I teach them templates and everything. That's pretty much what I do on weekends. So very much comfortable if you have guys have any questions.
Wow, I'm so glad to hear that. Yeah. So guys, if you have any, just put them in the chat box, or like if you're comfortable, you can also unmute yourselves one at a time and ask it to him. Since we have him right now, it's a great opportunity to connect with him and like gain as much knowledge as we can.
I'll definitely say one thing. People are running behind AI. I do have a post. I've not written that. There's SD. I wanted to say this somewhere. That's why I'm saying it here. AI is good enough. It's trending in the industry, but trust me, it's not gonna give you a job every time. Be careful about that thing. Every professor is behind this thing. Come on, let's do research paper. Come on, let's put research paper in IEEE publications. I've gone through that. Aaj tak ek bhi paper nahi gaya mera aage. Recently ek jayenga. That's my proposed algorithm. But when I talked with my cousin, he's an IBM researcher. I asked him that I've done 6 months of project and I want to put a research paper. You won't believe what he told me. He said, you guys are putting in research papers in 6 months. We take 6 months to decide the topic of the research paper. So that's the reality. And the reason is we are putting in research papers and everything into conferences which don't have that, you know, that that much of index, corpus index, or what they call. So don't just run behind AI and ML. Rather, take AI and ML as a domain. Use it into your projects to build up products having a smart feature. Don't just say that I increased the accuracy from 93 to 94. That doesn't make a difference in anyone's life. But if you come up with an CNN algorithm or an application which is able to, you know, identify those sign language things or something like that, something innovative, something which is being deployed, that would create an impact. That would create an impact on the interview. There you can actually tell him, I have done so and so thing. This is what the impact I've created. Because they are not concerned if you increase it from 93 to 94. Because in reality, it doesn't actually make a difference if 1% is just getting increased. A 1% of increased accuracy, still there's 6% of errors, right? So that's the thing.
Yeah, that's true, man.
I was in AI. I put my entire engineering into AI. That's the biggest mistake, I think. I think I should have done open source. I think I should have learned full stack. I think I should have done more of competitive coding. Yeah.
That always happens. You just, you know, this is the human mind, right? One shiny object or the other. So we have a couple of more questions. Yeah, it's a very trending thing. People call it the hottest job and all that. So everyone is doing that. I'm also doing that, to be very frank.
I did that.
Okay, so next question. Would you talk about AML? Oh, he did it right now.
Yeah.
Move on to the next question. What is the point of no return for the time needed to decide whether to study further or to work?
I'm sorry, I didn't get your question. What is the point of no return for the time needed to decide whether to study further or to work? I don't think I exactly get what your question is. Kritika, can you try that? I mean, what exactly she wants to ask?
I think I'm also trying to assimilate all that in my mind.
Okay.
Just unmute yourself.
Pradnya, you can do that.
So, hello, Fan. Thank you for your insights about how we should work for everything ahead. So, my question was. So now I'm in the second year and I've been getting to hear about all these pathways about how to go ahead. So basically my question is, how much more time should I take for deciding whether I need to study further or do I need to settle and start working for it?
Okay. Yes. Yeah, I get your question, and I can relate to that because
a lot of time to prepare for the competitive exams and everything. So there are two different paths. So for the better time management, what should I do?
I think it's a misconception people have that these are two different paths. There's only one additional exam, GRE, which comes into picture when you go for higher studies, right? That's one thing. There's the additional preparation part and all those visa kind of thing. All those things come into picture definitely. But try to understand it from this end. Let's take, for example, you're not sure today where you want to go, whether you're going to go for further studies or whether you're going to want to go for a job. You are actually going have to go with both, in the sense that GRE is something which you have to give one, prepare for 5-6 months and give that. But competitive coding or the CS fundamentals or the the interview stuff which I just spoke about, even if you do your master's, after that you're going to go for interviews, right? Someday down the line you're going to go for interviews. So at that point also you're going to need this stuff only. That's nothing like if you go for a master's, you're going to get everything, every interview is going to get cracked. No, it's not that. Ulta, I'll be frank with you. If I was reading interview experiences, when people from master's are actually giving interviews, more deliverables are expected. More better profile is expected from as compared to an undergrad. So don't think this has two different parts. Rather, keep going to see, have this as your backbone, that you understand computer science fundamentals and problem solving ability is your base. You go through your interviews, internships and everything. And at that point, you'll realize once you go into a corporate culture, an internship or something, at that point, you realize it's a personal decision whether to go for further studies or not. There's nothing of as such as someone else cannot call out for you, because I think it's not necessary to go to further studies just because you want to get placed into an MNC. People from India, people from tier 3 colleges have been placed into MNCs. It's both way around. So you just try to understand, just go with the flow as of now. Keep both things in your hand. At a time will come where you will take the decision that, okay, now it's the time I have to go. I decided that master suits me more. I want to study more. I want to do research more. That's where your 6 months of GRE comes into prep. At that time, you can limit down your competitive coding, focus more on it. But I'll tell you one thing. If you're going to go for GRE, make sure the score is 330 plus. Because what's happening today is every one of us, we've been the average student for 22 years of our life. We've been into colleges which are not known outside of a city. My college, I went into credits, so I said I'm from VIT. They said Vellore. And I'm like, no, VIT Pune. So that happens. So what I would suggest you is, even if you're going for a master's, make sure you crack the best university out there. I don't want you to just settle for some average university, because you're asking me this question in your second year. So target big university, target ambitious university, Purdue University, I don't remember the names. So target those universities if you want to go. But there's a time which will come where you will realize what exactly you want to pursue. For me, it was in my third year when I realized I want to do a master's. I applied to Italy. I got an admission from Politecnico di Milano, which is 100th best university in the world. That's the University of Milan, actually, which is in Italy. But due to pandemic, I was not able to go there. So then I decided, okay, let's move on to my career. I can build up my career. I can actually perform good things in my company, like I'm right now working on, and I'm pretty happy with it. So my perception changed there. I didn't go for master's then. Now I realize that, okay, this is something I'm liking. This is something I want to work for. I'm not going to go back to books and research papers. So I'm continuing with this right now. So there's a time which will come when you will get that instinct from inside that whether you're going to go for master's or full-time work, or there are combinations, hybrid thing people do. 1 year work karlo, uske baad ja. But just one thing, don't go with this perception that you're going to go to master's and okay, I'm going to get a Facebook directly. No, it's not that. It's you're going to get an opportunity for Facebook because they don't have a dev center in India. But you have to make sure that whatever your level is today, usse double level pe wo expect karenge aapse, because you are a grad from one of the top schools in US. You are a master student. You're no more a simple student. So that's what differentiates a master and a normal grad student. and decide according to you. Don't go on someone saying what to do in career. It's good to have opinions, but definitely it's personal, I guess. Masters ya fir work karna hai. I hope that answers your question.
Yes, it did. Thank you. Basically, yeah. The question I took majorly because of the time management. So yeah. Since you need to plan it beforehand, I had the question. Thank you.
Yeah, that's good.
Wow, that was a great answer, I must say. I guess we'll now close the Q&A session. And what can I say, man? I'm so overwhelmed. Thank you so much for this wonderful session. Yeah. I mean, you actually blocked your calendar for like 2 hours for, you know, enlightening us. We're so grateful for that. And right now I'm skimming through all the notes that I took from the session, and it's really very hard for me to pinpoint, wow, that this was amazing, because all the content was just superb. And the best part about today's session, I think, was that you were very, very honest with us. It was not just about rainbows and sunshine. You did not sugarcoat anything. So you gave us the real stuff. So that was really cool. Kudos to you for that. And I'm pretty sure that all the participants have gained many valuable insights, you know, what they need to do next, how. And I have a firm belief that this session will not just make us better coders, but on the contrary, it will also make us better problem solvers. So that is one great thing, and I love the terms that you coined, like resume story, and that was really cool. Now I'm also going to start using Google Docs for my coding questions. This session was like a complete roadmap for non off campus placements, and I think now all of us have an idea, like, to take the concrete actions to, you know, get placed in our dream companies. Thank you so much for that.
Thank you so much for having me, and all the best, everyone. Feel free to reach out to me on LinkedIn. If I don't reply you guys, just wait for a day or so. I might be busy with work, but definitely on weekends I'll get back to you. So feel free to reach out there. Thank you so much for having me. Have a nice day. Bye.
Thank you for engaging with us. We have, like, did you check the chat box? It's just flooding.
Yeah.
Thank yous. Wow, that's amazing.
This is awesome. Thank you, everyone. I mean, really, this is good to hear. And let's just one last thing. When I go out and teach people, or when I go out and tell people, that motivates me to do better. As a fact that, Afan, you stood in front of 50, 60 people. Now do something that you can stand in front of 500, 600 people. So that's the motivation which I get when I go into sessions. And trust me, one more thing, I'm not that kind of a nerd, which you guys might think. I think all of you are way, way smart than me. I've seen it in my juniors. They're pretty awesome. And I think you guys are very, very much hardworking than me. Don't find me as your role model. Don't stop at companies like Credit Suisse. I mean, it's very good company. I'm not saying that, but always target for something which you dream of, not something which I am. Don't look at me as a role model. Rather, look at people in Google as a role model, people in Amazon, people in Facebook, wherever you want to reach. You want to reach Harvard, look at those people as role models. Because I'm learning. So thank you so much for having me. And thank you for these awesome comments. I'm loving to read it.
Yep. We are honored to have you, Afan. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Happy weekend.
Yeah. Have a great weekend. Bye.
Bye. Thank you.